Our epistle lesson for today comes from Philippians chapter 1, verses 3 to 11. I thank my God every time I remember you, constantly praying with joy in every one of my prayers for all of you because of your sharing in the gospel from the first day until now. I am confident of this, that the one who began a good work among you will bring it to completion by the day of Jesus Christ. It is right for me to think this way about all of you, because you hold me in your heart. For all of you share in God's grace with me, both in my imprisonment and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel. For God is my witness, how I long for all of you with the compassion of Christ Jesus. And this is my prayer, that your love may overflow more and more with knowledge and full insight, to help you to determine what is best, so that in the day of Christ you may be pure and blameless, having produced the harvest of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ for the glory and praise of God. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
When I find myself in times of trouble, Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. In my hour of darkness, she is standing right in front of me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. Let it be, let it be, let it be, yeah, let it be. Whisper words of wisdom, let it be. Broken-hearted people living in the world agree, there will be an answer, let it be. For though they may be parted, there is still a chance that they will see. There will be an answer, let it be. Shine until tomorrow, let it be. I wake up to the sound of music, Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be.
So the poet, philosopher, theologian, prophet, John Lennon says, everything will be okay in the end. If it's not okay, it's not the end. We've all had clouded nights. We've all had times of trouble. We've all had things that seem to be obstacles to living our best lives. things that get in the way of experiencing the joy that is there for us. Some of those obstacles impact us personally. Some of those obstacles are there for our neighbors and affect our neighbors. But then again, we've got that whole love your neighbor as yourself thing going for us. So if it affects our neighbors, it really affects us too, doesn't it? Our neighbor's obstacles are our own. For Paul, the imprisonment that he describes in the first letter of Philippians is an obstacle. It's something that's preventing him from living out his calling, preventing him from living the life that God really wants him to live, doing what God wants him to do. And yet, he's able to overcome that obstacle, the obstacle of his imprisonment, by transforming it into an opportunity. As he did that, as he transformed this obstacle into opportunity, he was able to experience joy. You can hear the joy in this letter. For the next 4 weeks, we'll have a time to sit with Philippians for a little while and explore the joy that's in this letter. The series is called Joy Undiminished, the next 4 Sunday mornings here. And we're going to use Philippians every week and work our way through this letter. Philippi is Lydia's town. I talked about Lydia several weeks ago. So there's a really close relationship that Paul has with Lydia and with her circle and with the church at Philippi. You can hear this intimate connection in the letter itself. Even in the very first part of the letter, in the greeting, he is expressing this joy that he knows from his connection to them, even while he's in prison. He says he is constantly praying with joy for the people of Philippi because they are, quite frankly, amazing. They are doing wonderful things. I can relate, you know. I can relate to a pastor praying with joy for a church that is doing amazing things. Manchester is doing a lot of amazing things, and I remember you every day in my prayers, which are indeed filled with great joy for all the wonderfulness that is this congregation. He tells the people of Philippi that God has begun a good work in them, that he can see that good work that has begun, and he also expresses this confidence that God will be faithful to complete the good work that has been done. He can see that there is potential yet unmet. I can also relate to that as a pastor who sees potential yet unmet in the congregation. But listen to how he gets there. He expresses the joy of this moment, not because the work is completed, but because it's ongoing. The work has been begun, and God will bring it to completion. That is the source of the joy, not that it's finished, not that we're done, but that we're on the way. Joy doesn't mean that everything is fine. Joy means knowing that it will be. Everything will be okay in the end. If it's not okay, guess what? It's not the end. In fact, you can hear this transformation of obstacle into opportunity later in chapter 1 of Philippians. He indicates that his very imprisonment, that thing that we would think would be an obstacle, is in fact a way that the gospel of Jesus Christ is being spread. It is in fact an opportunity to share the gospel. He writes it this way: I want you to know, beloved, that what has happened to me has actually helped to spread the gospel, so that it has become known throughout the whole imperial guard and to everyone else that my imprisonment is for Christ. And most of the brothers and sisters, having been made confident in the Lord by my imprisonment, dare to speak the word with greater boldness and without fear. Remarkable. How is it that Paul can express this confidence, can have this level of faith? How is it that Paul can access this undiminished joy while he's literally in prison? What is the source of Paul's joy undiminished? So this is a picture of a little pocket cross, a hand cross that is intended to be held while you are praying. In fact, it is a picture of this very cross that I carry with me from time to time. It just so happens that this particular cross was given to all of the delegates to the General Conference in February of 2019 as a way to pray during that time. Maybe one of the, no, not maybe, it is one of the very few good things that actually happened at General Conference in February of 2019. The other being that the Manchester Chancel Choir sang at it. That's the other really good thing that happened there. So I have this cross, I've had it since February, but I lost it recently. No, actually, I shouldn't say I lost it. It was stolen from me recently. It was in my car. Oh. Yeah, so most of you apparently know my car was stolen. I told you a few weeks ago my car was stolen. And so it was recovered. And I went down to the city lot to check it out. It was completely wrecked. It had been in an accident. Undrivable. The inside of it is just filthy. It's just like indescribably just nasty in there. The airbags had deployed. It was a wreck. I was looking at this car and thinking about the people who took it, and I just was getting so mad. I felt this, I didn't know I had a reservoir of anger that deep. It was just, oh, I was so angry. And as I was looking around in the car, on the floor of the passenger seat, sits this cross. Now, I'm not one to just willy-nilly say that God put that cross right there in that moment for me to see. But maybe God put that cross right there in that moment for me to see. Right in the midst of that obstacle to grace, right in the midst of my anger and what was preventing me from living the best life, the life I could be living, here is the cross of Jesus Christ just sitting there on the floor of the car. It's counterintuitive though, isn't it? How is the cross of Jesus Christ a source of joy undiminished? How can that be that it's an instrument of execution. It's an instrument, a tool that the state used to kill criminals, to execute criminals. How is it that that's the source of joy? The cross of Jesus Christ. Well, the reason is that the cross is empty. That the cross is empty. That it has been transformed. That sorrow has become joy. Anger has become hope. Grief has become promise of new life. The joy is not in the cross itself. The joy is in what the cross points us toward. Namely, resurrection. And so here we sit on All Saints Sunday, remembering those dear to us who have died. Is there a more fitting time to remember resurrection? There is grief here, there is sorrow here. That grief points us to the promise of new life in Jesus Christ as sorrow becomes joy, as potential obstacles to living the life God wants us to live are transformed into opportunities. As Paul puts it later in the first chapter of Philippians, for me, living is Christ and dying is gain. Grief is a universal experience. We have all suffered loss. We all know the pain of the death of a loved one. And it may very well seem like it's an obstacle to joy, and it feels like that when it hits us. But grief, very much like Paul's imprisonment, can be overcome by transforming it into opportunity. Healthy grieving actually allows us to experience joy. We have to take that journey. We have to move through the grief into the promise of life everlasting, into the joy undiminished promised us and given us by the Holy Spirit. And the bonus is that that whole love your neighbor as yourself thing that we're so fond of, that means that we don't have to take that journey together. Nope. That we don't have to take that journey alone. That's much better. We don't have to take that journey of grief alone. In fact, we do take that journey together. We feel that grief together. We share that pain together. and it affects you personally or it affects your neighbor. Either way, we share that journey and that obstacle to living a beautiful, grace-filled life is transformed. And in the transformation of the obstacle, it is overcome. So we do experience the promise of life, abundant and everlasting. Today we also gather at the table, a table of Holy Communion. This sacrament of Holy Communion is a tangible expression of how God transforms obstacle into opportunity. We refer to Holy Communion as a means of grace. It is a conduit, if you will, through which God pours grace into the world. The grace is not in the bread and cup themselves. The grace is in what that bread and cup point us to, namely, the love of God in Christ Jesus brought to life by the power of God's Holy Spirit. Knowing God's grace means knowing that it will be okay in the end, that if it's not okay, it's not the end. Knowing that we work through the suffering and the pain and the grief of this world together as a community, as a family of faith, that God has indeed begun a good work within us and is faithful to complete it, and that the good work that God is doing with us is the grace of God bringing us toward that end, empowering us to live the life that we have indeed been created to live.